As if I'm not tall enough, right? They put me on the stage. Hello, everybody. So, my name is Mario. I come from a little country called Belgium. But I've been living and working in Asia for the past 16, 17 years. I currently live in Singapore. And there I work as an independent contractor. And I specialize in brand experience design. Big lofty words. Basically what I do is I connect brands with their people for the benefit of both. And that is regardless of channel, regardless of media or touch point, I just tackle the whole thing. That has allowed me to build quite a divergent set of expertise and skills. And I've done that for the past 25 years. But here's something else you need to know about me. I am a graphic designosaurus. I graduated before those computer things ruled the world. I learned how to do my craft with these things, with my hands. In fact, my very first job was spray gluing pages together for a mail order catalog. For the young people in the audience, yes, that actually did happen. Now, we all know what the story is. Computer came in, desktop publishing, and so over the years, for us designers, we've had just tremendous new possibilities, and with it, new requirements as to be a designer. And it's not just the way that we work that has very rapidly changed. Our design world is very rapidly changing as well. The once golden rule, the one you couldn't break, is no longer applicable. Form no longer needs to follow a function. Think about it, your laptop follows function. It's disappearing. In fact, products are disappearing. They are becoming services. Services have now led to the subscription economy, the Internet of Things, software as a service. It's a completely different play field. And we're not done yet. We are moving from the computer is everything to everything is the computer. We will soon be designing the interface for everything, for everyone, at any time, all the time. Technology is just going to be. It's a wave, it's a glance, it's a gesture, a swipe, it's everything. So we will be asked to design for that. And it's no longer one thing. It's going to be an entire ecosystem of things and services and products all in one bubble. Be it that the ecosystem exists or it doesn't, and we have to invent it. That's our job. But fear not. Design thinking is here, and it will keep us afloat. It will rescue us. Did you know that design thinking is actually not a design terminology? It didn't come from designers. It came from engineers. At one point in time, they were faced with what they called wicked problems. And that meant that it was more the expertise of other people that they had to help fix. So they brought them in, and then they figured out, so how do we do that? This is your world, not ours. I have to solve it. Where do we meet? So you get exercises and skill sets and workshops. Oh, you know, and that became design thinking. Now I'm going to confront you with this. Quite recently, Deloitte came out with a study on learning. And they could prove that your usable skill set is limited to 5 years. And then it's no longer practical. Then it's no longer of use. And I wasn't surprised. I'm living proof of that. I studied 4 years. Call myself a graphic designer. I did my job with those skill sets for one, and then they asked me to do it on a computer, and I couldn't. I never learned it. There was no skill. So that is still very prevalent today. Welcome to the deep end of our pool, my friends. That's your reality. The skills that you take on board, the time you need to master them is longer than the time those skill sets are needed. That's our reality. So, how do you build your career? How do you get longevity in this thing that we love, in design? I get asked that quite a lot. It's probably because I'm the graphic designosaurus. I've been around for 25 years. I had to learn how to kind of evolve in this industry to basically survive. So let's open the kimono, right? Let's see how that works. Design thinking, the term alone, is kind of mysterious. It holds a promise, but what is it really? If we look at it as only yet another set of skills, we may lose the magic of design thinking, because in 5 years' time, unless, it's no longer relevant. Well, I applied a bit of design thinking on that problem, and I want to share a few tips and pointers with you. For one, design is not a skill. I'm well aware that I'm being a bit disruptive here. In fact, you know, I'm this guy. I'm the black sheep in the industry. I'm here to tell you design is not a skill as much as it is a mindset. Craft will make you a good designer. Your mind will make you a great designer. You have to learn how to approach your craft in a particular mindset. So where do we start? Well, when an army goes out to fight, bit of a depressing topic, I'm sorry, but it gets the point across. When an army goes out to fight, it doesn't just send its troops out there. It goes and scouts. And a scout's job is not to fight. It's not to look where to go and fight. It's just to understand what is out there. And that's my message to begin. If you want to shift your design focus to a mindset and away from a skill set, try to understand before you try to solve. And we have a lot of pressure. Our boss wants an answer, our client needs it tomorrow. Well, hit the pause button. Try to inform decisions by understanding before you try to solve. Get a scout's mindset first. You'll have plenty of time to go to battle for your ideas later. If you don't, you will start based on your own assumptions and your past experience, and neither is a good place to start. The reason is if you do that, you become an island. You are limited in your own discipline and your own experience, and that's not good enough. And I understand why that happens. Our entire industry is built on islands. This is your classic agency model. Look there. See that one there? This one? Strategy island. All the strategists live there. Yeah? And you have visual design island, and technologies over there, and project management, yeah? And this is conference room island here. And then everyone comes together once, maybe twice a week, 2 hours of collaboration. All right, well, that doesn't work because collaboration is dead. Please do not collaborate. Oh, hold on. Page 3, design thinking, collaboration. Well, it depends on how you interpret collaboration. If I hear it, I hear go along to get along. Please follow me. Don't rock the boat. Collaborate. Come on. Come on. That's what I hear. And that's why this image is your average design meeting. That's your strategist and your technologist and your usability expert and your client, and they're having a meeting. A lot of bark. A lot of bark. No bite. So what do we do if we're not going to collaborate? Well, compare collaborate with co-create. If I ask you, let's collaborate, or I'm asking you, let's co-create, who feels empowered? Co-creation sounds, let's get things done. I'm ready. I'm inspired. I feel the energy. And that's based on what's below there. None of us is as smart as all of us. The point of discussion is not victory. It's progress. You review each other, you critique each other, you debate the problem. And that's done to move forward. That's not done to be smarter than anyone else. You're only smart if everyone else joins in. The other pitfall that you may have is that you yourself are in the way of ideas. You do something which is called fluent thinking. Basically what that means is, even if we know a little of something, we already think we know enough. So I hear you talk about an idea, it sounds familiar, yeah, no, don't like it, done. I didn't even try to understand why you talked to me about that idea that way. Fluent thinking, it's a trap. We do it to be efficient, we do it because our brain is just overwhelmed and we have a lot to get through the day for. But it's a trap. Catch yourself not falling in that trap. Understand what it is that you are switching into that automatic mode of fluent thinking. There's a couple of techniques for that. One is overload the problem. If you think you have an immediate answer to a problem, you're being lazy. The risk of your opinion doing the work is prevalent. So overload the problem, get new data in, find more research, dive in, and pretty soon, because of the volume of consumption of information that you're doing, your brain is going to go, wow. There's so much more I need to learn. How many of you have a bicycle? All right, on a scale from 1 to 10, 1 being I know nothing, to 10 I'm an expert. Or, you know, I know pretty much everything there is to know about a bicycle. Right? Scale from 1 to 10, who thinks he's a 7, 8? Right? So, if I now go to these people and I ask, so what's the power ratio between the height of your saddle and the force applied to your paddle to go 40 miles an hour? The scale goes back to 1. I just confronted you with fluent thinking, I know a lot. To disfluent thinking, I throw data at it and go, there's maybe just a little bit more that I need to know about this. Do that with every design group, please. The second technique to this, and Jeremy here had talked about that yesterday, is you reframe it. And this is the easiest one. If you have no time to overload yourself with data, do it this way. Share your idea with everyone in the room, have everyone do input, vote on it, sketch it, draw it, present it differently. Make people pause and think about it. We once uncovered that people were taking more time to understand our notes if we had really bad handwriting. You know, it took effort, like, what is this person thinking of? But your brain is starting to think as well. You don't just go, yeah, no, don't like it. It works. People are wonderfully complicated, right? The whole purpose of design thinking and the whole reason of UX is to design for people. Yeah, I see a lot of heads nod. Question yourselves. How many times do you design for people, not for outcomes? We design for outcomes. How about we design for behaviors that can influence those outcomes? Those outcomes are really not ours to dictate. They're ours to inspire, evoke, through the behavior of our people, the client. That takes a bit of effort in trying to understand who you're designing for. But here's what it does. It opens the window, the garage door, if you wish, to what the actual problem is. A lot of the times, our biggest effort is in getting the right problem to design for. It doesn't happen a lot. But how can you get the problem right if you chose the wrong problem to solve? Work on finding the right problem, then get to work on getting the problem right. Then the soldier hat will come on. This is a favorite industry jargon phrase, right? Low-hanging fruit, early victories. Well, it's a misunderstanding or a misinterpretation within the industry that complex problems need equally complex solutions. That's not the case. You break it down. You find what matters and what doesn't. Quite often in those complexities, some of these problems are not even worth solving. There's no money in it. There's no gain in it. There's no brand value in it. So don't solve it. Solve the ones you can solve, and solve the ones that you need to solve. Now, we're designers. This is our job. We are idea people. We need to protect the idea. We don't need to be in phase one with an amazing idea that gets us all excited. We jump out of bed the next day. We want to get going. And then we go into our next phase. And yet the idea is still kind of there, but it watered down and then watered down. By the end, you don't even recognize it anymore. Our job is to fight for the idea, protect the idea, bring it from start to finish. It must feel as exciting at the end as it was at the beginning. Because the good news for us is that we're in a profession where the work is just never done. You iterate, you find short bursts of new ideas, new solutions. You observe, you evaluate, go after it again. There is no end game. There is no finish line. That's good news for us. Means people like us will be needed for a very long time. They'll be needed for a very long time if we get our head around it and if we work on this profession with the right mindset. So here's a quick list down of what I was trying to share with you. Design's a mindset. You understand first, you define later. Do not work linear. So don't just stay within your own experience, try to solve it all by yourself, because you can't. They're all here, right? The other one I want to leave you with is just do it. You don't need permission. Excuse me, boss, can I? No, just do it. Make it the way you design. This is how you do your profession. You just do it, no permission needed. There you are. Take a deep breath. The best is yet to come. It'll be all right. Thank you very much.
It will be all work for outcomes. I mean, can you elaborate on that a bit more?
I want us to be the influencers of what we think might be an outcome, but we cannot dictate it. We cannot dictate it. I believe we're in a world where consumers are smart enough to know when they're being pushed in a direction that we want them to go. But they can be talked into it, nuanced into it, charmed into it. So understanding behaviors, I can give you a really quick example for it. We recently worked for a bank. They did a survey. The survey said people want an email with information for investment. It's bonsai, it's boring, I'm sorry, but it gets point across. So they sent the email out, and no one was really following up on it. There were no sales, there was no click-through, nothing. So they made more effort, still didn't. But the survey said 70% want the email. What they failed to understand was those 70% were people that got up at 5 o'clock in the morning, checked the markets from overnight, waited for Tokyo to go, see how the markets were moving. And before they were in the office, they had already made all their purchasing decisions and all their investment decisions. And then by 11 o'clock, the bank came with their email. Here's today. Too late. The behavior was not understood. The outcome was provided. You wanted an email? I'll give you an email. But they didn't understand the behavior. They didn't understand the source needed. So now they know they have to work a little bit different and a little bit harder to get the information to that customer overnight so that they wake up, they have the email, and now they're informed by their preferred bank. And boom, the numbers went up. That's the immediate example I came to mind. We focused on the behavior, not on the desired outcome.
Good afternoon, sir. This is Professor Amar of Vijayanagar Institute of Management. I'm a professor in Vijayanagar Institute of Management. Normally, when we teach our students, We take example of paints, wall paints. About 20 years back, we used to be shown cards of paints when we were to select some paint. But today, with very less number of inputs of raw materials, you'll be able to have billions of shades that the computer generates.
Yes.
And you'll be choosing it. So is that, that is the basic design for the tastes of the people. But the outcome is obviously profits for the company, because Asian Paints has actually been the leader in that. So in what way, what you have told in this particular slide is something new than what has been already implemented by Asian Paints.
And I'm sorry, you,
Shalik,
what was it? What was the question?
Asian Paints,
yes,
is a painting company,
yes,
wall paints company. It's a world leader. And earlier they used to have design meant for a limited number of paints, and you have to choose among the limited choices available.
Yes.
But later on, the technology has changed in such a way that with those very few inputs, they are able to make billions of choices as the computer mixing.
Yes.
Now that has been, that means you have made it a mass customization, as we call it in marketing principles.
Yes.
So in mass customization, it is the same thing, that your design is meant towards the people's taste, which is different in millions.
Right.
And the outcome was automatic, that it was generating profits for the Asian Paints company.
Right. So this particular context of what we are talking of, design for the people and not for the outcome, yes, is a existing thing already.
It could be that this company had a case for offering that particular service. They may have done, I don't know.
I'm not speaking for the company, but I would hope they would have done a design research where their customers were going, if only I had my shade of mustard yellow. And here comes along a technology that could offer it. If that is the case, then you could argue they've done a service for the people. If they're only using technology, like, oh, look what this can do, and I'm going to the market for it and kind of go like, you need to buy because I can do that, I believe they're on the wrong track. And I believe that, that it's a narrow path where they eventually will run out. What your story reminds me of is of the paradox of choice, where you have an ice cream shop that sells vanilla, chocolate, and banana flavored ice cream, that's it. And across the street you have one that goes, I've got 60 flavors. Well, your choice will be easier in shop one than it is in shop two. Because 60 flavors, where do you begin? But it could be possible that they just serve one particular group of people that want to have 60 choices of ice cream because of their behavior or their attitude. We cannot say one is better than the other. What it exposes is it's easier for you and me to make a choice if there's only three options versus 60. We actually experienced that yesterday. They gave us a drink menu that must have had 200 drinks in it. And you know, you just go, give me a beer.
Thank you. So.